Hello, I'm Minister Edward J. Robin. This is the 13th day of December 2021. I'd like to make a few comments to you today about the various proposals people are putting forward, how to end the tyranny, how to come out from underneath the COVID needle, how to rid yourself of graphene oxide, how to put your leaders in obedience to the law. That's what I'm going to be talking about today, and it's not very complex. The whole system of law set up throughout the Commonwealth and the free world is based in that Bible. Way back, they had to have the good moral structure to get people to vote them in, to trust them, and so they used the Bible. And that Bible is quite remarkable when you look at the 1611 King James or the 1599 Geneva, because it specifically tells us one word that is the nemesis of the whole system worldwide. Now, I caution people before they get judgmental and thinking that, well, one word couldn't affect a cure and a fix for a worldwide fraud. And actually, it does. It's extremely, extremely effective, and I'll tell you why. The King James Bible has the word person in it as something that God disrespects. It reveals that if you consider yourself a person or show respect to persons, you commit sin. You're a sinner and shall be convinced of the law as a transgressor. And as I have before, I'll just rattle off these scriptures. People can stop the recording or replay them. Deuteronomy 1:17, Deuteronomy 10:17, 2 Samuel 14 and 14, Matthew 22:16, Acts 10:34, Romans 2:11 and James 2:9 make it vividly clear that if you respect persons, you're a sinner. So now we have one thing to do. The whole rest of that system, whether it be the justice minister, the health minister, your local councils, your mayor, your provincial elect, your state sponsors, whoever they are, they're all persons because they have a title and an office that's personage. And if you communicate to them as those persons, then your faith and belief, if you have any, is for naught, because you just went and sinned by communicating with the persons. Whereas if you point them to those scriptures and ask them that if they recognize as your faith and beliefs, you can't respect persons, and they'll accept that you're communicating to them privately as a man or woman, so they'll know that the scriptures advise you and admonish you against respecting persons, and you share the scriptures with them. Now, the next thing, once you've established that you're not a person, can be regulated as a person, there's no jurisdiction over you at all since you're not a person, well, then you get an agreement that they recognize the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, because this is the secular system's top law. The insurance underwriters worldwide, worried that they're going to lose money, put the Human Rights Statute in place in 1948. And then 1979, they got these international covenants recognized and ratified in law. In Canada, it's written into the Emergencies Act, and it's the top law in all of the 172 countries that signed on to that. I'm going to repeat that again. 172 countries around the world have this as their supreme law, not their rags called constitutions, which were a set of rules for the debtors. People need to learn that that word constitutor means somebody who has promised to pay the debt of another. And a constitutor has a set of rules. It's called a constitution. So if you want to be a debtor, cling to your constitution, no problem. But if you want to be free and you want to be the creditor, you have to establish, the one, that you're not a person, and two, that you're not communicating to them to make use of their law, even though you're going to mention it. You're of a duty and an obligation to warn them. Ezekiel 33 in the King James Bible Old Testament puts an onus and a duty upon all ministers. The obligation is to warn those brothers that may be having intent on bringing harm to others, and to warn those that may be harmed. When you do so, you can make mention of his sword all you want, the length of it, the sharp of it, the breadth of it, who made it, anything you want to talk about the sword. That's man-made mammon's law. As long as you're saying, I'm the watchman, my duty is to warn you of your obligations under your own law to obey it, lest you put yourself into a damaged position where you're subject to that law because you violated it. So that's a pretty broad thing to understand, how you can make mention of their law without it being assumed that you're using it. Because if you use commercial copywritten intellectual property, for a benefit, well, now you owe the owner. You've submitted yourself to whoever owns that property, statute, code, and regulation. Whereas if you're mentioned to them as the duty of being a watchman, bound and obligated to warn them, well, now there's no assumption that you're making use of it for a benefit. You're merely carrying out your religious beliefs and duty to warn them of their obligation to ensure that they don't violate that law, bringing damages upon themselves and liability. Now, that little concept that I've shared with you, you can talk to 1,000 lawyers. You won't find one that'll understand it. That's scriptural wisdom. That's where I got that from, right out of the scriptures. I didn't have some lawyer or some guru come and tell me that. I got trained right out of the scriptures. I figured that out by reading them. I follow Christ. He tells you what to do. He said, go make friends of those unrighteous mammon. Why do you want to go argue with them? The whole world depends on your argument. If you're arguing, you're in dishonor. You're wicked. You're not agreeing with the truth and the way. You're supposed to gain an agreement with them. Matthew 5:25. You're supposed to do it privately with witnesses. Matthew 18:15-20. You have an obligation to not walk in the statute codes of the heathen. Leviticus 18:3-5. This is replete in an honor of following Exodus 20:3-5, where God commands us not to bow down to those false gods, and neither shall we serve them. Well, how can we study Matthew 6:24, do not mix God and mammon, and believe it if we're busy mixing God and mammon? All you got to do is pull your driver's license out of your pocket, and you'll see that you're in bed with the dead prostitute, and there's the dead name there, backwards in all capital letters, just like on a tombstone or an obituary column. Now, you can't deny that. You may not like it. But these are the simple facts that we're in bed with the dead as long as we're participating by making use of their statute, code, and regulation by even mentioning it. As long as you tell them that you're warning them of it, well, then there's no use of it. Your duty and obligation to make a warning takes away any assumption that you're using it for a benefit. There's no benefit to you. The benefit's to them if they're aware that if they break it, they'll be privately liable to you. Now they can save themselves harmless from that liability because you did the good deed of warning them. And so that little simple concept I wanted to share with people, because the whole world is confused under the assumption that they are persons. And I've spoke with tens of thousands of people, and I've rarely to meet somebody that knows that they're not a person. In school, we're all trained to understand that we're persons. In school, we're trained to write our name, first, middle, last, upper, lower case. Somehow, around high school, they started altering it for school ID and reversed it. Contrary to all style manuals in the world, there is not one style manual in the world that condones the use of an all capital letter name. It's just not part of the code. And yet we do have a law in Canada called fraud, where if you're altering somebody's name for a financial purpose without their consent, that's called fraud. And that's exactly what's taking place when the government takes it upon themselves to alter your name, reverse it, and capitalize it. It's not done for free. They're charging money to do that. So I hope this has provided a bit of information to those that are confused by the complexities of the world. Because I've only focused on a couple of things here, although I went into detail and covered all sides of it, I want everybody to make sure of all things. Make sure of your election. If you're electing a false god government as part of the ruling over your life, well, you guess you deserve what you get. You're going to be a slave now. But if you're electing Yahushua, Jesus the Christ, into your life to be your Lord and Savior and a master, you got to get an agreement with them privately that that's what you've done, and ask them, do they have any statute, code, or regulation or authority to intimidate you to not exercise or practice your faith in following Christ? Simple fact is they have zero. So it's quite amazing how such a simple position, almost childlike, Christ said you had to be as little children to get to the kingdom of heaven. So here we have it. You know, once you understand that you're not a person, well, that Deuteronomy 30:19 offering of death and cursing is starting to fade away. Whereas if you understand the John 15:16 offer that you're his minister, chosen by him and ordained to go forth and bear the fruit, well, now you're the man and is a minister. And you're truly receiving the life and the blessing that Deuteronomy 30:19 gives us the choice of. You're either a minister, one word, or you're a person, another word. So we have two words here, how to simplify, how to get any man or woman out of Babylon. If you understand those two words, and that you can't have all of those scriptures saying don't respect persons. And then now compel you, oh yeah, you have to. You have to register a person, have your name form like a person, etc. That's simply not true. So I'm hoping that you'll recognize there's an opportunity to demand accommodation, quote unquote. Go search that out a bit, because as of your faith, you cannot be discriminated against or forced or intimidated or nuisance to submit to statute, code, or regulation that's been added to and taken away from God's law in violation of Deuteronomy 4:2, Deuteronomy 12:32. This is very clear when Christ said in Matthew 15:9, "In vain do you worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men." If you're out there talking a pulpit and a scripture to people and you're carrying around a dead prostitute's driver's license in your pocket, you just contradicted yourself. You're still being ignored by Christ because you're still following the statute, code, and regulation of man. And by your action of doing so, you're exempting to others that they should as well. So I thought I would share this eye-opening, awakening type of information with those men and women out there eager to learn the truth. It is simple. It's not confusing. There's no divesting of the facts. Everything's before you now. You can examine those scriptures, and any questions you have of me, I'm willing to answer them, because what I provide is flawless silver bullet type of information. There's no assumption, there's no theory, it's all scriptural direction to a T. Thank you so much for taking your time to listen to me, and may God bless. Bye for now.